Good morning, everyone. My name is Elizabeth Liner, and I have Reba Latessa with me this morning, and we are going to be presenting Dancing with the Supremes and discussing Supreme Court cases impacting employers in this year's 2019 session, as well as some of the pending cases in the 2019-2020 session. And before we get started, I want to cover a few housekeeping issues. In the interface for this webinar, you'll see a question and answer box. Please feel free to submit questions during the presentation, and we'll try and respond during the discussions. Otherwise, we'll respond to the questions after the webinar is complete. Also, you'll be provided contact information for myself and Reba. Feel free to reach out to us directly if you have questions. We also want to ask you to please give us your feedback and fill out the survey at the end of the webinar. Also, you'll be receiving a PDF of the presentation at the end. Finally, please do feel free to connect with Baker Donelson on social media. You'll see links at the bottom of the page to our Twitter and LinkedIn accounts. So let's get started. So today's agenda is going to include the current composition of the U.S. Supreme Court, and then next we'll talk about some of the 2019 decisions. First, we'll discuss the arbitration agreement decisions that are relevant to employers. Then we'll talk about a few other Supreme Court decisions that have been rendered in 2019. Next, we'll move on to the 2019-2020 session. We'll talk about the sexual orientation transgender discrimination cases that are currently pending. And then finally, we'll discuss a few other pending cases that may impact employers in the coming months. And I'll hand it over to Reba.
Thanks, Beth. Good morning, everyone, and thank you for attending. Again, my name is Reba Letza, and I'm an associate here in our Baltimore office at Baker Donelson. I'm going to go over our run-through of the current composition of the United States Supreme Court and just give some information on how the court operates. So here we have a photo of all of the current sitting Supreme Court justices. In our front row, left to right, there's Justice Breyer, Justice Thomas, Chief Justice Roberts, Justice Ginsburg, and Justice Alito. So in the back row, there's Justice Gorsuch, Justice Sotomayor, Justice Kagan, and Justice Kavanaugh. So judicial power is passive and reactive. So Alexander Hamilton called judicial power in the judiciary branch the least dangerous branch of government because it doesn't have power over the purse or the sword. So in order for the Supreme Court, or any federal court for that matter, to hear a case, the case has to be ripe. So there has to be an actual issue for the court to decide. The case also can't be moot and can't involve a political question. A good example of a political question is an issue of impeachment. Courts don't hear impeachment. Congress hears cases of impeachment. So we also have a dual court system where cases go through the federal and state system, and those systems operate in the same geographic areas and during the same time. So back to our friend Alexander Hamilton's statement that the judiciary branch is the least dangerous branch. So the courts don't control the sword, which is what you think of police power, which would be the executive branch's role, or the purse, which is the spending power, which is Congress's role. So in the Supreme Court, there's a Chief Justice and eight other justices. So the Chief Justice is appointed by the President and confirmed by the Senate. The Chief Justice also handles a lot of the administrative tasks, such as determining who's going to issue an opinion, assigning judges to committees, and things of that matter. There's three primary ways that a case can reach the Supreme Court. The first way is the least common, and that's if the court has original jurisdiction over the case. The Supreme Court has original jurisdiction over cases, for example, between two states. So if Maryland sued Virginia, that would go directly to the Supreme Court. The second way is if cases go through the state courts or the federal court would be the third way. So after the justices hear oral argument on a case, which is happening now, an opinion is rendered. So there's what we call a dissenting opinion, which is when a justice disagrees with the majority's conclusion and how they got to the conclusion. We can also have a concurring opinion, where the justice may agree with the result, but may not agree with the reason as to how the court got there. So during the process of circulating an opinion, drafts are circulated amongst the justices, and then the opinion is released to the public. And sometimes, in some instances, the case is remanded back to the lower court to reconsider in light of some of the holdings that the Supreme Court may find. So now Beth is going to talk a little bit about the arbitration agreement decision.
So arbitration agreements with employers was a hot topic in 2018 for the Supreme Court. If you recall, Epic Systems was a pretty big decision that came out. 2019 also saw some impactful decisions in this area of law. Before we get started, we do want to ask you a few polling questions. So if you'll take a couple seconds and answer the questions as they appear, we want to get an idea of the experience that our audience has with arbitration agreements. We don't have a lot of folks who have arbitration agreements, so those who do can answer the next question. Otherwise, you can disregard. If you do have an agreement, we're interested to know whether your agreement includes an express waiver of the right to bring class actions. Okay, so just as a brief overview, arbitration agreements are entered into by some employers with their employees in order to develop a program for dispute resolution that is more cost effective and tends to be on an individualized basis and provides greater efficiency for resolving disputes between employers and employees. And the Supreme Court last year ruled that it was valid and enforceable to include an express waiver of class action in these agreements. Since then, the Supreme Court has had a couple of other decisions that have come before them in 2019 related to arbitration agreements, the enforcement of arbitration agreements with employees, and exceptions to such arbitration agreements. So the first case we're going to talk about is New Prime Inc. versus Oliveira. In this case, a truck driver filed a class action against New Prime Inc., arguing that the company didn't pay its driver's minimum wage. So New Prime filed a motion to compel arbitration based on an arbitration agreement that was included in the driver's independent contractor agreement. So the benefit of that would be that they would be able to go and proceed to arbitration on an individualized basis with this truck driver as opposed to defending a class action suit. However, the truck driver contended that his agreement with New Prime fell under Section 1 of the Federal Arbitration Act, which carves out coverage for contracts of employment with certain transportation workers. And in fact, it says nothing in the act shall apply to contracts of employment of seamen, railroad employees, or other classes of workers engaged in foreign or interstate commerce. So in response to the plaintiff's argument, New Prime said, well, first, our agreement includes what's called a delegation clause, and so the arbitrator should decide this threshold issue of whether Section 1 applies, not the court. Alternatively, Section 1 does not apply because it refers to contracts of employment, which did not include independent contractors. It is limited to the employee-employer relationship. In a unanimous decision rendered by the court on January 15th of 2019, the court held the contracts of employment include those that purport to establish an independent contractor relationship. So they looked to the original meaning and the evolution of the phrase contracts of employment, finding that it was not a term of art, and it generally referred to, in the broad sense, work agreements, quote unquote. Looking at the language of the FAA, looking to the next argument, whether this, so they concluded that the contracts of employment would encompass the contract between New Prime and the truck driver because it encompasses this independent contractor relationship. So the next question was whether or not the court could decide the issue of the applicability of Section 1. The court reasoned that because its ability to stay a case and compel arbitration was based on the coverage of the Federal Arbitration Act, if in fact the Federal Arbitration Act excluded this agreement, then it had no right to stay the litigation and compel arbitration. So in fact, it said that the court must determine whether Section 1 exclusion applies at the outset. And so it was for the court to decide, not the arbitrator. So the next case that came out regarding arbitration agreements is not necessarily an employment case, but it is one that could impact employer future decisions regarding employer arbitration agreements. The arbitration agreement at issue in Henry Schein versus Archer White, carved out certain disputes and said that it applied to all disputes except for those seeking injunctive relief and dealing in trademarks and trade secrets. So the plaintiff sued in federal court for violations of antitrust laws and sought damages as well as injunctive relief. So when Henry Schein, Inc., sought to compel arbitration, Archer White contended that the dispute was not subject to arbitration because they were seeking injunctive relief, which was excluded from the agreement. Well, similar to the last case, the agreement at issue included a delegation clause that required that all threshold issues be decided by the arbitrator, not the court. So the issue before the Supreme Court in this case is whether the arbitrator must determine the issue of arbitrability. So the Fifth Circuit and the District Court both looked at what's called the wholly groundless exception to the general rules under the FAA in order to deny the motion to compel arbitration in this case. So the wholly groundless exception says that when an argument for mandatory arbitration is wholly groundless, a court may resolve the threshold issue of arbitrability, regardless of whether the agreement delegated that question to the arbitrator. So the general rule under the FAA is that the arbitration agreement should be enforced according to its terms, and therefore, because this agreement included a delegation clause, the decision on the threshold issue of arbitrability should have gone to the arbitrator, not the court. However, the Fifth Circuit found that the wholly groundless exception granted them the right to decide this issue. The Supreme Court concluded that the wholly groundless exception is inconsistent with the FAA, and the Supreme Court held that it requires that the agreement be interpreted and enforced as written. So the court remanded the case back to the Fifth Circuit to decide the issue of whether the contract actually delegated threshold issues to the arbitrator. So the last arbitration case that the Supreme Court heard that relates to employment agreements was Lamps Plus versus Varela. And this one goes back to the question we asked about mandatory express waiver of class action. So in this case, a hacker convinced an employee of Lamps Plus to disclose tax information of about 1,300 employees of Lamps Plus. And then a fraudulent income tax return was filed in the name of Frank Varela. Mr. Varela filed a class action case against Lamps Plus on behalf of himself and all of the other employees affected by the data breach. In response, the employer, Lamps Plus, moved to compel arbitration on an individual basis based on the arbitration agreement it had with Mr. Varela. So the agreement actually said that the arbitration shall be in lieu of any and all lawsuits or other civil proceedings related to my employment. The district court and the Ninth Circuit found that the agreement was ambiguous and thus must be construed against the drafter. So ultimately, the Ninth Circuit held that because the agreement was ambiguous, that class-wide arbitration could be allowed as opposed to arbitration on an individualized basis. So when this came on appeal to the Supreme Court, the court first simply accepted the Ninth Circuit's conclusion that the agreement was ambiguous. And interestingly enough, in the Supreme Court's decision, three different justices addressed what the language actually meant and came to different conclusions, which only seems to support the reasoning that the agreement itself was ambiguous if there's three different interpretations in one ruling. So assuming that the agreement was ambiguous, the court looked to the issue as whether an ambiguous agreement can provide the necessary contractual basis for compelling class-wide arbitration. So the Supreme Court first stated that the availability of class arbitration is a matter of consent, and the parties must all have consented to class-wide arbitration. And then pointed out that there's a crucial difference between class arbitration and individual arbitration. And some of the big virtues of individual arbitration that they pointed to are the lower cost, greater efficiency, and the ability to choose experts to adjudicate and resolve the disputes. Ultimately, the court said that an ambiguous agreement was not sufficient to show that there was consent on the part of all the parties to engage in class-wide arbitration. Finally, there was one other decision that the Supreme Court denied cert on, and the issue there was whether the mandatory arbitration agreement covered the breach of duty, fiduciary duty claims brought by employees on behalf of their insurance plan. So the court in the Ninth Circuit concluded that the arbitration agreement did not cover these claims because the agreements referred to claims brought by the employees on their own behalf and did not include claims brought by the employees based on behalf of the plan. And as I said, the Supreme Court denied cert to hear those cases. So next, we're going to talk about a few other decisions from the Supreme Court in 2019, and I'll hand it off to Reba to do that.
Thanks, Beth. So we're going to start out with Fort Bend County versus Davis. So I'm going to start with a little bit of background on this case. Davis worked as an IT supervisor for the county. She filed a complaint of sexual harassment with the county's HR office, alleging that her supervisor, which was the IT director, was harassing her. And then the supervisor resigned from his position. And then a close personal friend of the director, she alleged, continued with the harassment as retaliation for her complaint. So she filed a charge with the Workforce Commission alleging sexual harassment and retaliation. So while her charge is pending, she was terminated for refusing to attend work on a Sunday to attend church instead. So she attempted to supplement her allegations on her charge by also handwriting religion on her intake form. So after she was issued her right to sue, she also added a religious discrimination claim. So this case went on and was litigated for years, and it was remanded from the Fifth Circuit, and the county which was her employer, ultimately moved to dismiss on the basis that she had never asserted that she was discriminated against based on her religion in her initial charge. And the district court agreed with her employer. So this case went back up to the Fifth Circuit, which reversed and held that a charge filing requirement wasn't just a mere jurisdictional requirement, but it was a claim processing rule that the county had waived its right to allege because they hadn't alleged it earlier. They had let the case continue for years of litigation. So the case ultimately went up to the Supreme Court, and the court agreed with the Fifth Circuit, which held that the requirement of Title VII is a mandatory rule and that an employer can waive their right to challenge the adequacy of a plaintiff's charge by waiting too long to challenge it. So several employers had a very strong reaction to this case, thinking that this decision would allow for employees to skip the administrative steps of having to file a charge for discrimination. But what the decision is really saying is that if an employer wants to raise the argument that an employee did not initially raise a certain charge or wants to challenge the sufficiency of that charge, the employer should raise it earlier rather than later and let the litigation continue. So this next case is a very interesting decision because it wasn't really decided on the merits of the actual case. So this case is about an employee of the Fresno County Office of Education who filed a claim in violation of the Equal Pay Act because she was paid at a different rate of pay than a male employee who was working in a similar position. So the employer's argument and justification for the pay disparity was that they were using the prior salary of that male employee to justify his rate of pay. So this case eventually got to the Ninth Circuit, which held that an employee's prior salary can't be used by an employer to justify a pay disparity for the same work when there's a male and female employee. So the Ninth Circuit opinion was written by a Judge Reinhardt. So this judge died shortly after writing the opinion, but he had also passed before the opinion was actually filed. So without his vote, the judges wouldn't have had enough votes to issue the decision because several of the judges did not agree with his reasoning. So the Supreme Court took cert to resolve the issue of whether a judge's vote counts toward the majority if he dies after the opinion is written but before it's filed. So the Supreme Court ultimately vacated the decision, holding that the judge lacked the authority to participate in the court's decision at the time that it was rendered. So the case was remanded back down to the Ninth Circuit. So Beth's gonna chime in and give some information on the practical implications of this case and some good takeaways.
So following the Supreme Court's order, the Ninth Circuit must now determine whether it would have enough votes for a majority of the en banc that heard the case to support the decision that was initially rendered. They have to first appoint another judge to reach the necessary number of judges on the en banc panel, which it looks like they did in April of this year, appoint Judge Carlos T. B. to replace Judge Reinhardt. So either they have to re-vote as an en banc panel, or if there's not enough for a majority vote to support the decision that was previously rendered, they may have to go through another round of oral arguments. But what this means for employers in the Ninth Circuit, that is, until the Ninth Circuit makes a move on this issue, the precedent remains that employers may use prior pay history as a factor other than sex to determine and develop the pay schemes it implements.
Thanks, Beth. So now we're going to talk about Parker Drilling. So this case arose out of a situation where there was an employee named Brian Newton who worked for a company called Parker Drilling, and he was performing his job duties off the coast of California in an area called the Outer Continental Shelf. So in his complaint, he alleged that he typically worked 12-hour days and was not provided with meal breaks for every 5 hours he worked, which was required by the law in the state of California. So after he was terminated, he sued his employer for wage and hour violations. So the case eventually got to the Supreme Court, and the issue for the court to determine was whether California wage law was applicable and not inconsistent with the Fair Labor Standards Act and whether it applied to this worker. So the lower court first sided with the employer, ruling that the wage and hour laws didn't apply in this area off the coast of California. But the Ninth Circuit reversed the decision, holding that the laws were applicable because they concerned the same subject matter and that they weren't inconsistent with federal law, which would be the Fair Labor Standards Act. So the Supreme Court reversed and remanded the lower court on the basis that the federal government had jurisdiction over that area and that federal law was the only law on the outer shelf that was applicable. So because federal law, the Fair Labor Standards Act, already addressed wages and hours, California law didn't apply. So the employee's claims that California law applied failed. He didn't prevail, and the court remanded the case so that the claims that hadn't been analyzed in that same decision could be litigated.
So next, we're going to move on to sexual orientation and transgender discrimination cases that are pending before the Supreme Court right now. So we had a question come in before the webinar, and someone asked what the decision of 2019-2020 term that was the most impactful. And our opinion is that this decision, once it's been rendered, will have the biggest impact on employers in evaluating what types of claims they will have to address, whether sexual orientation and transgender discrimination might in fact be encompassed by Title VII, will have a huge impact on employers in the coming months. So the Supreme Court on April 22, 2019, granted cert in three cases and consolidated them on these issues. So we have Zarda versus Altitude Express and Bostock versus Clayton County, Georgia. Both address the issue of whether sexual orientation discrimination is actionable under Title VII. And there's a circuit split on this issue. The 11th Circuit and the 5th Circuit have both found that sexual orientation discrimination is not covered by Title VII, whereas the 2nd Circuit and the 7th Circuit have found to the contrary. And then the third case that's been granted cert is EEOC versus RG and GR Harris Funeral Homes, and that case addresses the issue of whether transgender discrimination is covered under Title VII. In anticipation of these pending cases, the U.S. House recently passed what was called the Equality Act. Now, this act would prohibit discrimination based on sex, sexual orientation, and gender identity in a wide variety of areas, including public accommodations and employment. It would also prohibit the Religious Freedoms Restoration Act from providing a claim or defense in response to such claims. Now, this bill has not passed the Senate, so it's still hanging around out there. Now, the cases, just to give you a little background, Zarda versus Altitude Express. Plaintiff was working as a skydiving instructor for Altitude Express, and he was a gay man who sometimes told his female clients about his sexual orientation in order to provide them comfort with regard to being strapped to the front of him during tandem skydives. At some point, a female client alleged that the plaintiff had inappropriately touched her during a diving session, and when his boss confronted him about the issue, he told his boss, "No, that's not possible, I'm gay," and was subsequently terminated. The plaintiff then filed a discrimination charge with the EEOC and brought a claim in court against Altitude Express, claiming that they had fired him in violation of Title VII by terminating him because of his sexual orientation. The district court ruled in the employer's favor and dismissed the matter, finding that Title VII did not protect discrimination on the basis of sexual orientation. Plaintiff moved for the district court to reinstate his Title VII claim, but the district court denied the motion, so plaintiff appealed to the Second Circuit. Then a three-judge panel affirmed the district court's decision in favor of Altitude Express. Plaintiff requested a rehearing en banc, and it was the en banc panel that overturned the decision and found that sexual orientation discrimination constitutes discrimination under Title VII. So, the issue before the Supreme Court is whether sexual orientation discrimination is actionable under Title VII. The next case of Bostock versus Clayton County, Gerald Bostock was a gay man who worked for a child welfare services coordinator. And 10 years into his career, he started playing on a gay softball team and started to receive criticism for this. He was openly criticized at work, and around the same time, Clayton County informed him that he would be subject to an internal audit of the program's funds that he managed. Shortly afterward, Clayton County terminated Bostock for conduct unbecoming its employees. Bostock then filed a charge of discrimination and later filed a pro se lawsuit against Clayton, Georgia County, claiming that he was discriminated based on his sexual orientation in violation of Title VII. So the district court dismissed his lawsuit for failure to state a claim, finding that his interpretation that Title VII prohibited discrimination on the basis of sexual orientation was unsupported. Bostock appealed to the 11th Circuit, and the 11th Circuit, adhering to Fifth Circuit precedent, held that sexual orientation discrimination is not covered under Title VII. So these two competing cases are up before the Supreme Court, and oral arguments were heard on October 8th of this year, and we are expecting a decision with regard to those two cases soon. And I'm going to let Reba tell you about the funeral home case.
So Harris Funeral Homes is the transgender discrimination case that's currently before the court. So this case is about a transgender woman named Amy Stevens who worked at a funeral home as a funeral director for 6 years. So for most of her tenure there, she did live as a man, but she informed the funeral home's owner that she intended to transition from male to female and that she intended to report to work wearing the traditional conservative skirt suit or dress that the female employees wore. So when the employer heard this information, she was subsequently terminated. So the EEOC sued on her behalf, alleging that the funeral home terminated her in violation of Title VII of the Civil Rights Act, which prohibits unlawful sex discrimination. So the district court held that the employer was exempt from Title VII in exercising their sincerely held religious beliefs. And then the employer argued on the basis of the Religious Freedom Restoration Act, which Beth had just talked about. So the Sixth Circuit reversed the district court's decision and agreed with Ms. Stevens that her termination constituted sex discrimination in violation of Title VII. So the Supreme Court heard oral argument on October 8th to determine whether transgender discrimination is actionable under Title VII. So in this next slide, we have a graphic from the oral argument in the two consolidated decisions that Beth discussed. So Pamela Carlin, who is a professor at Stanford Law School, she argued on behalf of Bostock and Zarda. Her argument centered around the fact that if these two men were women who had revealed that they were interested in dating men, they wouldn't have been terminated. So that distinction in itself constitutes sex discrimination, which is prohibited by Title VII. So Jeffrey Harris argued for the employer, and he argued that Congress didn't intend for the Civil Rights Act to ban discrimination on the basis of sexual orientation, and that sexual orientation is distinct from sex. So he bolstered his argument by the fact that several states have enacted legislation to specifically address sexual orientation discrimination. So he used that argument to emphasize the fact that sexual orientation and sex were two separate concepts. So it was a very hot bench. The justices had several different questions. They questioned whether counsel was asking for them to rewrite Title VII by including sexual orientation in the definition of sex. So in the second case, David Cole for the ACLU argued on behalf of Stevens, and his argument was that the employee was terminated for failing to adhere to his supervisor's traditional gender norms in regard to how a man should present and appear and how a woman should present and appear. And John Birch argued for the funeral home. He argued that treating men and women equally doesn't mean necessarily that you have to treat men the same that you would treat women. He further suggested that if the plaintiffs prevailed in this case, for an example, an overnight shelter for women would have to hire a transgender woman, even if some of the women had been victims of domestic violence or even rape. So one surprising revelation during oral argument was Justice Gorsuch, who is a traditional textualist, which means that he believes that the Constitution should be interpreted by the actual words that are used. He described the case as a really close case and said that, assume for the moment that I'm with you on the textual evidence. So that kind of gave us a glimpse as to how the court may be likely to rule in this case. He also spoke of a massive social upheaval if the court were to rule for the LGBTQ plaintiffs. So the Supreme Court also denied to hear a case called Parker versus Rima Consulting. So this was a very interesting case. This was a case where a female employee, there was a rumor spread about her that she had slept her way to the top and slept with her supervisor in order to get a promotion. And this rumor was started by another disgruntled employee that was not promoted at the same time that Evangeline Parker was promoted. So the district court dismissed her claim, holding that these allegations of harassment weren't necessarily motivated by her gender, but they were just false allegations based on her conduct. So the plaintiff appealed the case to the Fourth Circuit for the court to determine whether this rumor could give rise to her employer's liability under Title VII. So the Fourth Circuit reversed on the basis that a rumor that a female subordinate had sex with a male superior to obtain a promotion tapped into an old and deeply rooted perception that women, not men, use sex to achieve professional success. And that was part of the judge's remarks during oral argument. So some key takeaways for employers after this decision are that it's important to maintain confidentiality when you're confronted with sensitive allegations. The next takeaway is to treat similarly situated employees consistently. And then the third important thing that this decision tells us is to quickly investigate these issues when they arise. Something that the judges at oral argument seemed to take issue with in this case was that there were several supervisors and other employees that were spreading this rumor instead of trying to dispel it or not promote it or make people know that it's not true. So that was something that just the judges were very concerned about, that the supervisors allowed this information to go forward and cast the plaintiff in such a negative light. So now I'm going to talk about two other pending Supreme Court decisions that involve ERISA, which is the Employee Retirement Income Security Act. So the first case is called Salima. In this case, Salima filed a class action lawsuit against his employer, and the allegations were that the company's fiduciaries invested the employee's retirement funds in violation of ERISA. So on a motion for summary judgment, the employer argued that the plaintiff's claims were barred by ERISA's 3-year statute of limitations for these types of claims because the plan's disclosures gave the parties knowledge of the breach. So the district court agreed, but then the Ninth Circuit reversed the decision, finding that a plaintiff must be actually aware not only that a breach occurred, but of the actual nature of the breach. So in this case, the Supreme Court's going to resolve what it means to have actual knowledge of a breach. So then the second decision is Jander. The Supreme Court granted cert on June 4th, and this case centers around the more harm than good pleading standard in the Fifth Third Bancorp case for when a fiduciary has to disclose information related to employer stock. So what the Fifth Third Bancorp decision stated was that a plaintiff only has to allege that a prudent fiduciary in the defendant's position could not have concluded that an alternative course of action would do more harm than good to the retirement fund. So most courts find that plaintiffs don't meet this high pleading standard in these employer stock drop cases. The Second Circuit reversed dismissal and this created a circuit split between the Fifth and Sixth Circuits. So in this pending case, the Supreme Court's going to address the issue of whether these allegations of an inevitable disclosure of an alleged fraud increase over time and whether that satisfies the more harm than good pleading standard, which was stated in the Fifth Third Bancorp case.
So the next case we're going to talk about is Babb versus Wilkie. The Supreme Court is considering this case, and it's kind of an interesting case. So Norris Babb was working as a pharmacist for the Veteran Affairs Medical Center in Bay Pines, Florida, and she's been working there since 2004. And while she was there, she helped develop a program called Geriatric Pharmacotherapy Clinic, which serves older veterans with diseases and disabilities common to individuals with advanced age who've served in the military. Now, in 2009, pharmacy management gave Babb an advanced scope to basically they advanced her from just a pharmacist and gave her an advanced scope pharmacy license, which gave her the authority to practice to basically full practice. And she was able to prescribe medications in conjunction with this geriatric pharmacotherapy clinic to the individuals who came into the clinic. Then in 2010, her program was rolled out nationwide for the VA Medical Center. So, as part of the program rolling out, pharmacy management had a number of regular module pharmacists applying for this advanced scope license in order to have authority to do what Babb was doing for these GPCs, the Geriatric Pharmacotherapy Clinics. Of the applications, several were rejected, and almost all of those that were rejected were females over 50, whereas two applications were granted who were pharmacists under the age of 40. So two of the female pharmacists who had applied and been denied advancement filed charges with the EEOC, and Babb provided statements and testified in support of their claims with the EEOC. So the pharmacists claimed that their denial of advanced scope was pretext for discrimination, and that in fact they were denied advanced scope licenses because of their age and gender. So later, Babb alleges that she was required to work a schedule for her department that was untenable, and that she was unable to meet the requirements that were placed on her. And the VA ultimately removed her advanced scope, and she was consequently disqualified for the promotion of handling the GPC. So after that, a female pharmacist, but one under the age of 30, was selected for her position. Ultimately, Babb brought an action under Title VII and the ADEA, the Age Discrimination and Employment Act, alleging that she was a victim of gender and age discrimination, and that she was retaliated against by the VA because she participated in the EEOC investigations related to the other pharmacist's EEOC charges. So the district court granted summary judgment in favor of the VA in this case, and then Babb appealed to the 11th Circuit, claiming that the district court had erred by not allowing her to show that the illegal discrimination and retaliation under the ADEA was the motivating factor behind the VA's refusal to promote her. The 11th Circuit affirmed the lower court's decision, finding that the precedent required the federal sector employees to prove claims under the ADEA and Title VII requires that plaintiffs show that the discrimination or retaliation was the but-for cause of the adverse personnel action. So the issue in this case that's come before the Supreme Court is whether a plaintiff raising a claim for retaliation under Title VII or a claim under the ADEA for discrimination must prove but-for causation or something less. So the U.S. Supreme Court has previously held that the ADEA provision applicable to private sector employers requires but-for causation. And that was the case of Gross versus FBL Financial Services. The Supreme Court has also held in University of Texas Southwest Medical Center versus Nassar that retaliation claims require that the plaintiff prove that the retaliation was the but-for cause of the adverse employment decision. So the court is looking to whether the language that provides for the federal sector provisions under Title VII and the ADEA requires that same level of but-for proof. So we're looking to see what the court says there. But interestingly enough, there is proposed federal legislation related to this. Protecting Older Workers Against Discrimination Act proposes to overturn both the Gross case and the Nassar case to create a uniform causation standard of motivating factor across all federal employment discrimination statutes. And obviously, this one has not yet passed, but again, it is proposed legislation before the Senate. So that concludes our discussion of the 2019-2020 Supreme Court cases. If anyone has any questions they would like to submit, we did receive one that asked, what does but-for cause mean? So but-for cause is different from motivating factor in that but-for means that it is the adverse employment decision would not have occurred but for the action that was the protected activity. So in the case of Bab, if she had not gone to the EEOC and testified in the cases of the other two pharmacists, she would not have been terminated. And she has to prove that there is a but-for connection between those two incidents. Whereas motivating factor would mean that she could show that the employer had one reason, but in addition, the fact that she testified in the cases before the EEOC was also a motivating factor that contributed to the decision. And that's the distinction there between but-for versus motivating factor. And the motivating factor is a lesser standard for the plaintiff to have to meet. So it will be impactful to see where the Supreme Court lands on that for federal sector employers. However, unless the legislation passed, private sector employers should be able to rely on the decisions of Gross and Nassar to know that they are going to be able to rely on the but-for standard in any litigation that relates to retaliation or ADEA age discrimination. So are there any other questions? So one point I did want to circle back and make for you all related to the arbitration decisions, especially considering the number of responses we got where folks said that they do not have arbitration or dispute resolution programs in place. Something to think about is that the reason that arbitration agreements are so highly litigated and such a big hot topic before the Supreme Court is because plaintiff's attorneys tend to find them highly undesirable and would choose to file class actions, collective actions with regard to wage claims, with regard to discrimination claims, where they can, in order to get a large group of plaintiffs together and put a great deal of pressure on employers and defendants, whereas having things like arbitration and dispute resolution programs in place provide certain protections, especially when you include language that creates an express waiver of class arbitration, class litigation, and collective actions, basically requiring that the employee assert their claims on an individual basis, that puts a stop in place against these plaintiff's attorneys who like to go out and try and file collective and class actions to put pressure on employers to pay out big settlements. So those are some things to think about. Let's see, I think we got another question. Do we know the status? The HR, that is, I'm sorry. So we had a question asked, do we know the status of House Bill 5 in the Senate? House Bill 5 was the one related to the Equality Act, for those of you who don't recall, and that I'll jump back to that slide for you. And yes, the status is that it is currently still with the Senate. It has been called for a vote twice, but not yet voted on, and it is still hanging out there. So one question we received is what we would recommend as far as next steps for HR professionals with regard to this information. And I think it's with each case, there are some steps that you need to take into consideration. So if we go back to the arbitration decisions, you'll see that the Supreme Court continues to be very employer-friendly with regard to these arbitration agreements. So it's a good time to look at and consider implementing arbitration agreements where you might not otherwise have them. Then we can look at decisions that relate to, so for example, Fort Bend versus Davis. In that case, the takeaway for HR professionals is that if you've got an employee who files an EEOC charge and you realize that the EEOC charge was untimely, as the HR professional who receives that charge coming in, you know, you want to alert everyone to that fact early on and make it very clear that the charge was untimely and they failed to exhaust administrative remedies so that that defense never gets waived. And then I don't know how many folks we have that fall under the Ninth Circuit, but the Yovano versus Rizzo, you'll want to look at your pay structures and are you considering pay history when you're setting out the pay structures for men versus women in your company. And that one, again, because of the remand, we won't really know where the Ninth Circuit stands until they have had a full en banc decision there, but as of now, you can continue to consider pay history in developing your pay structures. For those who have employees, and this is going to be employers who are probably oil and gas companies, the Parker versus Drilling case may very well impact you on how you decide to handle wage and hour decisions because you're going to be able to feel rest assured that the Fair Labor Standards Act is what applies, not the state wage and hour provisions, because the Supreme Court has made it very clear that under the Outer Continental Shelf Lands Act, those employees who are working on the Outer Continental Shelf are going to be subject to the Fair Labor Standards Act as opposed to any other more restrictive state wage and hour requirements. And then obviously everyone is going to be looking to see how the transgender and sexual orientation decisions come down. Now, as far as HR professionals, you should probably be looking to and be aware of any sort of local ordinances, state laws in that regard, as well as what the Supreme Court does there, because some states already do have in place protections for sexual orientation and transgender, and certainly should be considering whether those protections are already in place or will have to be adjusted and implemented if the Supreme Court rules in favor of the plaintiffs in those cases. So those are some high-level points to consider when thinking about, from an HR perspective, what you need to take away from each of these cases. We appreciate y'all signing on, and if you have any other questions, please feel free to submit them. And as I said at the beginning, you can contact myself or Reba directly. And we appreciate all of you for your time and hope you have a great day.